So as we discussed earlier, pressure measurement is a critical aspect in industrial instrumentation. We have different types of pressure measuring instruments, and we also discussed what are different types of pressures that we come across in instrumentation. Now, coming to this session, in this session, we will discuss about the measuring of vacuum pressure. That means any pressure which is below atmospheric pressure is termed as vacuum. Hence, the measurement of pressure below the atmospheric pressure is called as vacuum pressure. In measurement of vacuum pressure, we have different types: mechanical type, thermal type, ionization type, and radiation type. These pressure measuring instruments are used for vacuum pressure. And one of the primitive old techniques of pressure measurement is MacLeod gauge. It is just similar to the manometer type. Here we have multiple compression technique. We can see in the diagram we are having the vacuum which is given, which is connected at the upper part of the MacLeod gauge, and you have reservoir, you will have bulb B, and you will have a capillary A. So the gauge is used to compress a small quantity of low pressure gas to produce a readable large pressure. That means here the MacLeod gauge is connected to the vacuum, and this vacuum will be converted into a large pressure with the help of the gauge. So the gauge is used to compress a small quantity of low pressure gas to produce a large pressure. The MacLeod gauge is independent of gas composition. The bulb B of the gauge is attached to the capillary A. The mercury level in the gauge is lowered up to a certain point by lowering the reservoir and allowing a little process fluid to enter the bulb B. By raising the reservoir, the gas is now compressed in the capillary until the mercury rises to the zero mark and the capillary. The capillary is required to avoid any kind of instrument errors due to the capillary. So that is all about the measurement of pressure by using a MacLeod gauge. Another type of vacuum pressure measuring device is thermocouple vacuum gauge. Here it is a hot wire temperature measured by thermocouple. The sensitivity of this gauge will depend upon the pressure and the wire current. So we can see in the diagram, the vacuum is to be measured by connecting this thermocouple vacuum gauge. This gauge is connected to the tube where we are going to measure the vacuum. And due to the variation of the pressure, there will be a change in the wire current. So this wire current is due to the thermocouple. So that is how we are going to determine the vacuum measurement by using a thermocouple. This is a small example where a thermocouple vacuum gauge is used for measurement of low pressures, that is vacuum pressures. Here, two sets of thermocouples are used to measure temperatures of heater wires in two chambers and oppose each other. When there is a difference in pressure, there occurs an unbalanced, which is measured by potentiometer circuit. Instead of a single thermocouple, a thermopile is also used to measure the vacuum pressure, which can increase the sensitivity of the instrument. That means instead of a single thermocouple, you can use a number of thermocouples. Group of thermocouples is called thermopile. So instead of a thermocouple, I can use a thermopile for higher sensitivity of pressure measurement. And another set of instruments which are used for vacuum pressure is ionization gauges. The ionization gauges are used for vacuum pressure measurement. They are classified into two types: hot cathode ionization gauge and cold cathode ionization gauge. So here, in case of hot cathode type, a column of gas is introduced into which a potential difference is applied with free electrons in space. This causes the electron with a charge to acquire a kinetic energy. If the pressure range of the gas in the column goes below a certain limit called the critical pressure, then corresponding to the voltage larger than the critical voltage, the energy may be high enough to initiate ionization, and the positive ions will be produced when the electrons collide with the gas molecules. Here we have different types of gases which are used: cesium and helium, and also we can use for nitrogen and hydrogen. So there will be an ionization potential where the pressure is being considered. So at very low pressures, during the intervals of time for transit from cathode to the plate in a vacuum chamber, for a given fixed accelerating potential, the number of positive ions formed would be linearly with the value of pressure. Hence, a rate of determination of the production of positive ions for a given electronic current should give the measurement of the pressure. That means here, the rate of production of positive ions for a given electron current will give the measurement of the vacuum pressure. So this is the inherent principle of ionization gauge by using hot cathode. Here, hot cathode type ionization gauge consists of a basic vacuum triode. You can see this is a triode. The grid is at large positive potential with respect to the cathode and the plate. The plate is at the negative potential with respect to the cathode. This method is known as external control type ionization gauge, as the positive ion collector is external to the electron collector grid with respect to the cathode. The positive ions available between the grid and the cathode will be drawn by the cathode, and those between the grid and the plate will be collected by the plate. So this is an external type hot ionization gauge. So the number of electrons produced will be positive ions will be produced will be proportional to the vacuum pressure. That is the principle of operation of hot ionization gauge. Coming to the cold cathode type, it consists of two cathodes and a hollow anode in between. You can see in the diagram, it consists of two cathodes and we have an anode between those two cathodes. Input voltage greater than 2 kilovolts is applied between them. A strong magnetic field is produced due to the applied voltage, and hence the electrons are ejected. At pressures below 10 power minus 2 torr, the mean free path of the gas is so large that a collision may not occur at all, so that the discharge is not sustained or ionization may not be initiated. We can say that there will be ionization between due to the voltage and the magnetic field which are applied in a cross-sectional view. We can see in the diagram. So ionization gauges are used for measurement of vacuum pressure, and we have two types of ionization gauges. One is hot ionization gauges, and second one is cold ionization gauges. In hot cathode ionization gauges, the electrons are generated, or the positive ions are generated, and this will be proportional to the vacuum pressure. Whereas in cold cathode, the electrons are ejected due to the interference of the magnetic field and the electric field. So this is the principle of operation of measurement of vacuum using hot cathode ionization gauges and cold cathode ionization gauges. And coming to the differential pressure measurement, we have flapper nozzle mechanism for the measurement of differential pressure. Here you can see in the diagram, the supply pressure will pass through the restriction, and you have signal pressure, and you will be having a small arrangement called flapper and nozzle. You can see in the diagram, nozzle and flapper. There will be movement of the flapper in upward direction or downward direction depending upon the pressure that is coming through the nozzle. So the signal conversion from pressure to mechanical motion will be provided by flapper nozzle system. You can see the block diagram here. You are having supply pressure, restriction, signal pressure. You are having a nozzle and you are having a flapper. The gap between the flapper and nozzle will depend upon the pressure that is generated from the nozzle. A regulated supply of pressure, usually over 20 psig, provides a source of air through the restriction. The nozzle is open at the end, where the gap exists between the nozzle and flapper, and the air escapes in this region. If the flapper moves down and closes off the nozzle opening so that no air leaks, the signal pressure will rise to the supply pressure. As the flapper moves away, the signal pressure will drop because of the leaking gas. Finally, when the flapper is far away, the pressure will stabilize at some value determined by the maximum leak through the nozzle. So that means the signal pressure and the gap will be decided depending upon the movement of the flapper. So here you can see in the diagram the signal pressure versus the gap distance. A flapper nozzle is designed to operate in the central region where the slope of the line is the greatest. So this is used in pneumatic controller design. So the response will be determined in such a way, a small movement of the flapper can change the pressure by an order of higher magnitude. So this is the principle of the flapper nozzle mechanism, which is used for differential pressure measurement. You are having current to pressure converters. The I2P converter gives a linear way of translating 4 to 20 milliamps current into 3 to 15 psi signal. So as we discussed earlier, the standard current range is 4 to 20 milliamps. The standard pressure range is 3 to 15 psi. The reason for these values is because under these ranges, we will get a linear curve. There are many designs for these converters, but the flapper nozzle mechanism will be the basic principle of operation for the converters. So in this session, we have discussed about the measurement of vacuum by using Pirani gauges, thermocouple gauges, hot cathode ionization gauge, cold cathode ionization gauge, and also measurement of differential pressure by using flapper nozzle mechanism.